bitch, I'm flowing straight from the survival scroll.
Got him.
Here's
a little something about a nigga like me. Never should have been let out the penitentiary. Ice Cube will like to say that I'm a crazy motherfucker from around the way.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Mack Lessons Radio. And I'm your host, Mr. Tariq King Flex Nasheed. Glad to have everybody back tuning in to the show. Today's show is going to be excellent. On today's show, we're going to talk about Mack history. Today's show is a special show because you guys are going to get a Mack history lesson. We're going to break down the history of the Mackin game. And as usual, the show is brought to you by MackLessons.com, where you can get the Mack Lessons DVD. Also, check out my books, The Art of Mackin, at Amazon.com. My book, Play or Be Played, Everything That Women Need to Know About Men Dating and Relationships. You can also get that at Amazon.com. Women out there, I know I have a lot of women listeners. Ladies, you got to get that book. That book has a lot of good game for the ladies. Ladies, if you read that book, you will never have men problems again. You get real relationship advice from a male's point of view, and not one of them brown nosing ass niggas. You know, I tell you some real shit. That's going to be helpful to you. And fellas, don't forget to check out The Mack Within. You can also get that at Amazon.com. And I'm flowing straight from the goddamn survival scrolls. Now, today's show, you're going to get a Mack history lesson. We're going to talk about the history of Macks, like I said, the history of Mackin. Now, a lot of people talk about Mack this, player that, pimp that, and they really don't know the origin of these terms. And the reason why I want to give everybody a Mack history lesson, I want people to understand the rich and deep history of the game so they can respect the game more. See, in order to be thorough in the game, you have to respect the game. And the game is to be respected. Now, a lot of people don't know the etymology of a lot of words pertaining to the game. They don't know where these terms come from. Mack, player, hustler, pimp. They don't know the origin of this stuff. So you're going to get first-hand game that you cannot get anywhere else, even in history books. A lot of history books don't even know the origin of some of these words. All of it is like word of mouth. It's an oral tradition that's been passed down over the years. And plus, I've done a lot of my own research, and I've come up with new theories that a lot of scholars are talking about. Because if you look at the history books and the book of origins, or books about the origins of words, they always say certain words pertaining to the game are unknown. Where they're going to be known today. And some of you might need to take notes. Some of you guys in college, a lot of people out there listening, because this is some real deep shit. I'm telling you, this is some historical shit that they're going to start putting in the history books. When I go on my lecture tours, my college tours, a lot of history professors, they trip on this shit because it makes sense. They know I know what the fuck I'm talking about. Anyway, the origin of the word Mack, M-A-C-K. How did that evolve into pertaining to players, hustlers, pimps? Because that's what people associate the word Mack with. Players, hustlers, pimps. The word Mack dates back to the time of Caligula. Now, Caligula was a Roman emperor from way back in the day. Now, Caligula was a known freak. Caligula was into all types of shit. He was into men, he was into women, he was into incest. I mean, this motherfucker would fuck everything. It was also rumored that Caligula was into bestiality. I mean, this motherfucker would fuck, or rumored, be rumored to have sex with horses, all types of shit. a real freak. Now, Caligula had a partner named Macro, and Macro's name was M-A-C-R-O. And Macro had a wife named Ennia. Now, Caligula's freaky ass started having an affair with Macro's wife. Now, Macro knew about it, but Macro was a player about his shit. Macro stepped to Ennia, and he was like, basically, I know you're fucking with Caligula. I know he's a freak. So while you're fucking with him, bitch, why don't you get some money out of his ass? And I'm kind of paraphrasing. But Macro was like, yo, you need to, you know, bring a little something, you know, get something from this freak ass nigga. And, you know, she would kind of get Caligula to break bread. Ennia was making this motherfucker come up with some tangibles. Now, Caligula found out that Macro was doing this and had him sentenced to death for pandering. This was the first case of basically pimping and hoeing. So, Macro's name became synonymous with prostitution, because he was basically the middleman in between a prostitution deal. So that's where that name comes from. The word Mac is a shortened version. Now, in French, the French term for pimp is macaro. It's spelled a different way. And don't ask me to spell it right now, because I try to be fluent on my French, but I'm not. But if you look it up, the French term for pimp is macaro. Now, prostitution was pretty big in France. I mean, there was a lot of major league hoeing going on in France. Now, in America, prostitution became big in New Orleans, because New Orleans is very, is highly influenced by the French. It was very influential. It was very influenced by French culture, is what I'm trying to say. So the French brought a lot of their terms and their styles and their swagger into the New Orleans area. Prostitution was very big down there, and the terminology. So they would use the word macaro for men who ran brothels. And the term was shortened to Mack men, because in New Orleans there was a lot of what's called cat houses, a lot of brothels, the Moulin Rouge. I mean, there was big ass hoeing going on down in New Orleans, down in the French quarters, which is still going on. You know, they still have that theme, the Moulin Rouge theme, and that's where that comes from. So as prostitution spread out across America, that term Mac just evolved to pimp, then it evolved into men who are players, then it evolved into a word that described just general hustlers, men who had good game. And let's talk about the evolution of the American black male hustler. That brings us to that topic. Now, the American black male hustler is something to be admired. See, after slavery, you know, they had the Reconstruction period, and a lot of black men moved north, they moved around the country, and a lot of black men started very successful businesses, very successful legitimate businesses. And as a matter of fact, there was a place in Tulsa, Oklahoma called the Black Wall Street. Now, I know when a lot of people hear the word Black Wall Street or hear the term Black Wall Street, you associate that with the rapper Game. That's the name of his organization. That's the name of his production company, the Black Wall Street, for all you hip-hop heads out there. Now, Black Wall Street was the name of an actual street in the 1920s. Bet you guys didn't know that, did you? That's where the Game got that term from, got the word from, got the phrase from, Black Wall Street. There was a street in Tulsa, Oklahoma, in the 1920s called Black Wall Street, where a lot of black successful businessmen were raking in dough. These brothers were putting the shit down. Legitimately. These guys, they had businesses that were thriving better than white businesses. And it was called Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. You guys need to look that shit up. It's something to be very proud of. These brothers were not fucking around. Now, this being America, they weren't really going to let black men bubble like that. Now, they would let black women do it. They let black women get all the money they wanted to get. Such as Madam C.J. Walker. She was the first female millionaire ever in this country. The first self-made female millionaire, white or black. So she wasn't really a threat. They let the sisters make their money, but they weren't about to let brothers prosper legitimately like that. So Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma was eventually bombed. There was a big race riot in the 1920s, one of the biggest in the country, actually. They just needed reason to just start fucking up niggas' shit. They created a race riot, and the government literally bombed that whole section of Tulsa, Oklahoma, destroyed it. And there were other race riots in other booming black cities and black towns that were trying to do shit on the legitimate level. Like that movie Rosewood, it told the story about a real city where black people were trying to do business, and they burned that shit down. So that was the general consensus back then. Whenever black men would try to do some fly shit legitimately, they would tear that shit down. As they do today, in a sense. But back then, it was more blatant. They just really didn't want you to have no fly shit. They weren't going to let no brother have no fly shit. So what happened, a lot of those black men, in order to thrive, in order to make their money, a lot of them had to go underground. A lot of them had to be on the low with it. I know a lot of brothers, I've heard stories of a lot of black men, they would get white friends to buy land in their name. Or they would get white friends to go into the leasing office to open up certain businesses. But a lot of guys, a lot of black men had to go underground and just become hustlers with their shit. Now in the South, a lot of black men became like moonshiners or bootleggers. They would sell whiskey. Now if you are black and you have grandparents or elderly people who live down South, just sit down and chop it up with them, and they'll tell you about the bootlegging that went on back in the day, back in the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, all up into the 60s. Even my grandparents, they were bootleggers. Because the jobs available for black men back then, the square jobs, they had like fucked up jobs that were life-threatening, like jobs in the coal mine where brothers would get the black lung and TB and shit like that. So brothers had to do something in order to stay alive. So brothers back then, they had to get their hustle on. Now in some of the more urban cities, not the urban cities, but the more metropolitan cities, the bigger cities, brothers had to come up with different hustles. So you had cats like pimps, you had pickpocketers, you had what's called confidence men who would come up with different schemes where they use other people and talk them into a scheme. You had what's called paper hangers, people who would like deal with bounce checks or forged checks. So brothers had to hustle like that. But the most lucrative hustle was the pimping. It was the most well-respected hustle. Because it was all about using your mouthpiece. And the pimps had to be real thorough with their game. And they formed like a fraternity, the first pimps. And it was called the Sportin' Life. later on shortened to The Life. If you talk to any old school player today, they'll refer to themselves as being in The Life. And the term Sport and Life came from a book called Porgy and Bess that was written in 1925. And there was a character in that book who was a drug dealer named Sport and Life. So a lot of the players back then adopted those terms. And they formed like a fraternity called The Life. And in this fraternity, they created rules, regulations, and guidelines. And the reason why pimping was very lucrative is because a lot of black women who were freed during slavery, during that Reconstruction time, they were moving up north, but they still were cavorting with the white males up there. And a lot of these sisters felt like they had to do it out of obligation, but these players, these street cats, stepped in and said, "Hey, you know what? Slavery is over. You ain't gotta sit up and bone these motherfuckers like that no more. You need to holler at these motherfuckers about breaking bread. You did? He's not massa no more. You need to make this motherfucker come out his pocket. Got it?" So that's how the pimping was born in this country. And these guys created rules and regulations and guidelines in order to stay afloat in the game. And brothers back then, you would never know that they were PIs. They were just very well-dressed, articulate brothers. These cats were tailored. You would never know. You just see a guy fresh to death in a tailored suit, ride and fly. You didn't know what he was about. You didn't know what this dude was doing. Now, the game became more of a caricature later on down the line. Now, when Iceberg Slim came out with his book in 1969, that was the first glimpse that mainstream society saw of the game, of The Life. And that shit blew everybody's mind. And Iceberg Slim has become the pinnacle of what pimping is to a lot of people. Whenever you think of pimping, the first thing you think of is Iceberg Slim. Because his book was the absolute first book that gave people a glimpse into that secret underworld, that fraternity. Now, a lot of people don't know that Iceberg Slim wasn't really considered a good pimp by pimp terms. And a lot of guys learned pimping from Iceberg Slim's books, but truth be told, a lot of the true to the game, diehard old school pimps didn't really like Iceberg Slim's style. But Iceberg Slim's book was great nonetheless because he was a great writer. Excellent writer. But a lot of people took his stuff as gospel. But a lot of real true to the game players, they read the book and they're like, okay, this is cool. This is what goes on. But also, a lot of this shit is what not to do. Not to do in the game. A lot of the guys who were true to the book of pimping, true to that unwritten rule book of pimping, they didn't like Iceberg Slim because Iceberg Slim broke a lot of rules in the book. Number one, he was like sadistically violent with the women, which was a no-no. A lot of the old school pimps didn't like jumping on women, you know, violently like that, just to the point of death. Iceberg Slim, that style, they were like damn near about to kill a bitch, beating bitches with hangers and all that. Also, what the old school players didn't like about Iceberg Slim, he was a drug user. That's another no-no in the game. He was a drug addict. Because a lot of people back in the, you know, 60s, 70s, you know, they would casually use coke and this and that. But Iceberg Slim was a drug addict. So a lot of cats weren't too particular about that. But Iceberg Slim was a great writer, excellent writer nonetheless. So in the 70s, you know, after Iceberg Slim's book came out, there was an explosion of pimping. And the game was out there in the forefront. The 70s was a very open year. The civil rights movement was over. The women's liberation movement was over. So women can do what they want to do. Men could do what they want to do. Black men can do what they want to do. So everybody was just having a free fall. And in the 80s, the game slowed down a little bit. The game got kind of fucked up. But number one, the crack game. When crack came into play, that fucked up everything. And plus, during the 70s, there was a lot of single women having kids because the family unit wasn't really personified as much in the 70s. So it was all about individuality and independence. So a lot of women had these children by themselves, and these kids grew up in basically broken homes. And these kids grew up with a feminine mind state, especially the men. So a lot of simping started happening in the 80s and the 90s. There was a lot of simping going on. A lot of sensitive ass, brown nosing men in the 80s and 90s. And that fucked the game up a little bit. Now y'all remember what we had in the 90s and the 80s. I mean, you know the music we had. This is the music we had. That's the music we had going on in the 80s and 90s. Really, Mack is...
alone with you inside my mind.
We were not Mackish.
And in my dreams I've kissed your lips.
There was no Mackin going on when this shit came out.
I sometimes see you pass outside my door. Hello.
And for those real brown nosing ass niggas, y'all remember this shit in the 90s? Y'all remember that old simping ass hoe ass shit? That's what was going on in the 80s and 90s right there. The Mackin game was damn near obsolete. I mean, the Mackin game had took a big dive around this time. Niggas were real sensitive. Now, I know there's a lot of teens out there who might not even remember this shit. Like, in the late 80s, early 90s, you were like a baby. But this is the shit that motherfuckers had to deal with. And for them real simping ass brown noses, y'all remember this shit? Just when you thought it wouldn't get no worse back in the 90s as far as men. See, there was like either cats were trying to be extra gangster or they want this shit.
What kind of man would leave you standing in the cold?
Yeah, the game had really fell off in the 80s and 90s, man. Niggas was brown nosing bitches. Niggas was tricking like crazy. The bunch of crack babies being born. The feminist movement had taken hold. That shit was crazy. What was the game to do? Listen to this shit. That nigga said he'll buy the bitch's clothes. Listen to this shit. He'll pay the bitch's rent. So that was going on back then. That was a number one song. That was a hit record. This nigga talking about paying the bitch's rent, buying her clothes. That was the general mind state back then. So how could some Mackin survive that shit? How can you spit some good Mackin at a bitch and this nigga out here brown nosing with an S curl? And I had one too, so I can't front shit. But anyway, in the 90s, it got kind of simpish. Everything got kind of sensitive. Everything was geared towards females. Even the books, the Men Are From Mars type books, Women Are From Venus, those were books that were geared towards women, trying to teach men how to be more sensitive. So at the end of the decade, in the beginning of 2000, I said enough is enough, and that's when I wrote The Art of Mackin. Because I got tired of the brown nosing, I wanted to bring Mackin back. And the reason I wanted to bring it back is because I wanted to fill that void that was missing. There was a void for real man shit. There weren't no real men talking real shit. Everything had to be all sensitive and politically correct, and I wanted to create a forum where brothers can chop up real game. And I wanted to write a relationship book that real men could understand without being apologetic to the female audience. And what I wanted to do, I wanted to pay homage to the Macs out there that I learned my game from. I learned a lot of my game from these street players, these old school players. So I wanted to kind of give a shout out to them with the book. That's why I named the book The Art of Mackin. When you look at it, The Art of Mackin is basically a relationship book. It's no different than Dr. Phil or Men Are From Mars. I'm just talking in real ass terms that real dudes want to hear. Without kissing women's asses. See, when people think of Mackin, they think, well, he's trying to teach guys how to be Macs and he's trying to teach guys how to be pimps. That's absolutely not the case. And most cats who read my book, they see that. They know the game. And a lot of women who are getting into the book now, they know what's up too. And here we are with Mack Lessons. We brought Mackin back. It's coming back now. We're getting that man revolution going on right now. We're getting rid of all the simp-ass bullshit. We're bringing the game back to the level of respect so guys can chop it up with respect. We're creating forums where real men can chop it up. See, for the average man, a real man in this country, they really don't have anything entertaining for them. If you look at television, television isn't entertaining for men. There's nothing on TV for men. You got shit like Queer Eye for the Straight Guy, like I talked about before. All these little hoochie-ass shows on TV that real guys don't want to check out. That's why people tune into the podcast all the time. This is the realest shit that's going out there in the airwaves. This is the realest shit that's going on out there right now. You're not getting it from music. Music used to be kind of informative, but now it's a caricature of real life. It's like a lot of people say, they compare rap music to WWF right now. It's like, everything is exaggerated. I got the biggest house. I got a million bitches. I got 30 kilos of coke. And the fuck up. Niggas don't want to hear fantasies no more. People want to hear real shit. That's why it confuses people as to why I've sold so many books and why I do sold out lectures. Because I'm saying some real shit. That's not an exaggeration. That's not a caricature. I'm saying some real shit that the average cat can understand. It's that simple. And we're going to keep on spitting it. We're going to keep the revolution going. I'm telling y'all, we're starting a Mac revolution. We're starting a player revolution. We're bringing that shit back. And you ladies better get on board. Anyway, that's been today's Mack Lessons. I hope that was very informative for you guys out there. The Mack History Lesson. Don't forget to check out kingflex.org. Go to amazon.com, get The Mack Within, get The Art of Mackin, get Player Be Played. And go to myspace.com/Tariq_Nasheed. And don't forget, you can check out the show. You can just go to iTunes and subscribe to the show. You get it downloaded free every single goddamn day. All right? I'll holler at y'all niggas tomorrow. Peace.